Born ready.
It's Wednesday. You're tuning in to the Just Eldredge podcast, your favorite podcaster's favorite podcast. I just got back from my Montego Bay tan, and I feel like the man. Let's vibe. When I wake up in the morning, y'all do me a favor, turn this up. And the sunlight hurts my eyes. If you have any negative energy, get that shit out your heart. Today, all we want is positivity. Today is going to be an absolutely, positively, undoubtedly, the best, most amazing day you're going to have all week. Today's going to be lovely. I got to let it drop right here. You know what, keep it, Mark? It's going to be a what? Hey, hey, hey. We're going to do it like this. What's up, family? It's your boy, Eldredge. You tune into the greatest podcast to ever hit the airwaves. That is the Just Eldredge podcast. I am super excited. I'm about to record the greatest episode I have ever recorded. I say it every time, and I mean it every single time. Turn that back up. Hey, 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 hey. All right, we're doing it like that. I'm sorry. Family, I'm back. Round of applause. First of all, I want to thank each and every last person that tuned in to last week's episode, the Little Brother episode. Round of applause. Featuring Troy, his little bro, my little cousin, and Maul. I think Maul been on the podcast about 12 times now. I think he's definitely...
Yeah, made his rounds.
Yeah, he's definitely the most return guest on here. Before I get into it, let me introduce a first-time guest. Never been on a podcast, but it's somebody I've been cool with for, how many years now? 3 years?
Yeah.
Dang, time fly, boy.
Flying, bro. Damn. COVID year. It took a year off.
Yeah, hey, you know, 2020 do be like a blip year. Marvel fans, like... It was just like a year that just didn't even really count. So, yeah, 3 years.
Yeah, I'm glad to be here, bro. I know we had some schedule and then I backed out on you, but yeah, I'm in this seat now. We chat. we rapping.
It's all good. It wasn't official because if it was official schedule, you wouldn't have been on today.
But tell them how I pulled up today, though, for real.
Yeah, like, no, literally today, before I even introduce who he is, you know, I'm just calling. I'm doing my rounds where I'm trying to check in on people on the regular. And this one of the brother, I was just kind of checking in. I was like, man, you know what? We haven't talked about this subject on the podcast. I'm like, bro, you want to come through today? I said, you want to come on the podcast? He said,
it's
when?
It's like 5:45 p.m.
Yeah, it's like 5:45. Like, when? I'm like, shit, recording at 7. And my nigga came through. So, ladies and gentlemen, for the first time on the podcast, give it up for my big brother, Chubb.
Glad to be here, bro. Appreciate you having me.
Chubb, man. We're going to get into you real fast, but... Mm-hmm. Check in with my boys, man. How y'all weekend was, gentlemen? Keith, Mark.
Hey, man. You know, another weekend.
What about you, Mark? First of all, we got the camera here today.
We got video. We back on YouTube.
We on YouTube. YouTube looking like a gap.
Yeah, video. Man, we all on the tube, man. All over the web like a spider. Weekend was cool. I'm trying to think. A few days before the weekend was my baby girl's birthday.
Yeah, I seen that, man. Dang,
one year, man, I kept a human alive for a whole year.
That's crazy.
You know what I'm saying?
That's a crazy way to say that shit.
Yeah, like, I kept a human alive for a whole year, man. So it was dope, man. Got to celebrate with some cool people, some good friends, some good family. Had a real good time. So. Yeah, it was cool.
Did she smash the cake? Y'all did the cake?
Yeah, we did the cake. Yeah, man, she had some gifts that she really loved. When we sang happy birthday, she looked at everybody and, like, just started giggling, started laughing and all of that. So
she stayed up the whole time?
Bruh, the whole time.
Damn! These pandemic babies, they different.
Look, man, and had a good time. Like, she was, like, the happiest baby the whole time. Like, towards the end, she was sleepy, but, like... She would happy the whole time.
I seen that. I was like, man, that's what's up, man. Like, you had put some stuff on your story. I commented on it. I was like, man, this shit beautiful, man.
But appreciate it. But We went all out, bro. I spent a couple of dollars, but we look anything for her.
And speaking of a like couple of dollars,
get bigger and bigger. Well, how was your weekend, brothers?
As the people know, I went to Jamaica. Had a good trip. Shout out to Yada. Ran into Yada and Ron. Good friends. That was out there. I look, man, it's crazy when you run into people you know outside the country. That
world
shit.
World is small,
that
bro.
Shit always.
It's a small
like,
world. You yeah, can't that, get away with shit.
That shit was, that was, that was cool.
That shit make you feel like the man, though. Huh?
Yeah. And then, strip club. Went to the strip club in Montego Bay, man. Shout out to Black China. She said she was going to listen to my shit. Black China, I told you I can give you a shout out. What's up, baby? Jano. Pussy feel wet like a big bitch. Hey, that motherfucker. Hey, let me tell y'all. Her name was Black China, but then it was this other girl that was at least 6'4". Like, solid. I'm talking about made Meg the Stallion look like a little cousin, bro. Like, I'm talking about Shawty was like, I'm like, girl, this girl about to get on the pole. The pole bending with her, bro. Like, I'm talking about.
She said, I'm obsessed with thick women and I agree.
Hey.
That's right. I like
hey,
my girls.
Hey, Keith on point today.
It was every day. That's, hey, Keith, come on. This
I love it.
We in season three. Season three. New sounds.
That sound, bro.
So, look, check this out, though. Shawty wasn't even really like a BBW. She was like an Amazon. Like a Montego Bay, Jamaican Amazon. Like, Shawty was so big, my Shawty was like, God damn. You know how it is when your Shawty look at a girl, right?
Yeah.
And then, have y'all ever been to strip club with your girl? This first time ever for me.
Never.
Nah. Anybody ever? I'm like anti-strip club.
My girl's anti-strip.
So I don't like going to strip clubs because I got a problem. Like, you know, I'm a philanthropist. So I don't like going to strip club and
paying them ties.
Yeah, look, and you know, I be looking at it like, man, these sisters, they done already put themselves out here getting on stage. They deserve our best.
I was just trying to save them. Like, girl, you don't gotta be in here. You're too fine for this club.
Every one of them.
Look, I'm trying to pay book scholarships. Listen to stories. Like,
Shawty's don't strip for school no more, though. So that
misses out. Now Shawty's strip for lifestyle.
Yeah.
Like, so I was with the one Shawty, and she said, you want to go to the back room? I was like, I can hear you fine from here.
Damn.
That back room different.
Hey, look, I ain't going to lie. If the back room would have been by the bathroom, I would have tried.
Sir!
My girl, like, first of all, the reason why I was in rare form, my girl wanted to go. I didn't want to go. She wanted to go.
She was feeling Black China.
Nah, she wasn't. She was like, yeah, we can go. Like, I ain't gonna lie, she had showed a little gangster in her that night because she was like, yeah, you can bring another one. Like, she threw a little money, bring another one to me. I was like, no, I ain't finished with her. Overall, it was a good trip, man. We back here. But let's get into it, man.
my brother, man, Chubb, can you tell the people just who you are, like, just a little bit about who you are and why you're here? I just want to set the tone for the conversation and why this subject is so important for me.
Right, yeah. Currently, I'm a venture capitalist, but in my past life, 2016 to 2019, played in the NFL.
Who you play for?
Panthers, Rams. Started out with the Rams, and then my last 2 years with Charlotte, Carolina Panthers in Charlotte. And, you know, just I like to think of myself as a professional businessman, right? So I'm not just one thing. I'm not a football player. I'm not a venture capitalist. I'm not a podcaster. I'm not, you know me. I'm at the gathering spot. I'm two laptops just trying to figure shit out, trying to put things together, sacrifice right now while I still got my youth in me and, you know, ride that roller coaster towards the end of my life. So just setting and planting these seeds for the future.
Where do you play college and high school?
Went to Wake Forest from Marietta, Georgia. So I went to Hillgrove.
Okay.
Appreciate it. We got some dogs. in Powder Springs, Georgia, and then went to Wake Forest from 11 to 15, got an econ degree there, and went to the NFL from there, and now using that econ degree.
All right, just run for a minute, because they be switching shit up, right? Mm-hmm. What were your positions, high school positions, college to NFL?
Yeah, and that's a great question, because high school played defense end. So in high school, I'm a nice-sized defense end. I was getting sacks, doing what the team needed me to do, right? They put me in that position. We had linebackers. We didn't have any defense ends. I could go get the quarterback. Went to college, first year, moved me to linebacker. So I had the red shirt, sit a year out, and really just learned that position, right? I went from having my hand in the dirt, just rushing off the edge at an angle.
To
at
the
one.
Red step, yeah. To that read step, yeah. You know what I'm saying? Then, back side to her nose.
Yeah,
like,
exactly. Running at one object. And then now I'm in the middle of a defense, and things are going left, right, up, and down, and I got to dissect all that in the span of 2 seconds.
Literally,
and
then one
react.
Step.
Right. Yeah, in one step, right? And so that took a year of me just learning the position, practicing, being on a scout team, getting beat up by the offense, the starting offense, and really just cutting my nails at it, right? And then parlaying that into a freshman season, and then three-year starter, sophomore, junior, and senior year to all ACC linebacker.
Dang. Now, y'all heard that little language. That's linebacker talk right there. I played a little bit. You know what I'm saying? I know about it.
Yeah, for sure.
I know about it. That guard stand up, that's a pass.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? You know?
A lot you got to read.
Hey, you got to read that shit. But I'm the man of that shit. I ain't going to lie. Quit playing with me. So what about –
dig through the crates. Dig through the crates.
All right. So, boom. You going to the NFL.
Yep.
Talk about draft night. How was that, bro?
Draft night for me was, you know, a memorable night, but not for a good reason. So – I went undrafted. Draft is 7 rounds, 3 days long. I knew I wasn't going first round, but I was a first team all ACC, number one linebacker in the ACC coming out of my senior year, but I had no combine invite, had no all-star game invite. So kind of the writing was on the wall. I just didn't want to read it at the time. So draft day, first round goes on that Thursday night. I obviously knew I wasn't getting selected, but watched it just to see my peers get drafted and see what teams took what. If this team took a linebacker, I kind of checked that team out my head of me possibly getting drafted by them. And then Friday, that's 3 rounds, second, third, fourth. And I thought that was my day. So I'm sitting at the couch, literally in my crib, parents around me, didn't have no party or anything like that. Because like I said, the writing was kind of on the wall, and I, you know, want to put myself in that position.
You didn't put a you deal with them nigga, dude. I'm throwing a kit back.
Right.
Right. Throw a party.
Yeah. Yeah. You want to pull up, you can come. I'm not inviting you, though. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, the pressure ain't on me.
Look cute. Might delete later.
Right. Exactly. So, it was kind of that vibe. And then sat on the couch for 3 hours. Went undrafted. I was like, all right, cool. Saturday, that's my day. I didn't want to go Saturday. I wanted to go Friday. Saturday, this is my day. It's the 5th, 6th, 7th round. That's a 5-hour journey. Didn't get a phone call. And so Rams called me right after the draft. Or Rams called my agent. My agent called me right after the draft. Said, hey, you're going to L.A. They didn't draft any linebackers. They took all offensive players. That was the year Jared Goff went number one.
Nice.
And then they took like 3 other guys, 2 receivers and 2 tight ends. He said, this is a great situation for you. Do you want me to tell them you're interested? He said, yeah. And then next thing you know, next week I was in L.A. for minicamp. And so that was my intro to the NFL was L.A., Los Angeles, California. Rams first year back in Los Angeles, California.
I remember that.
Hard Knocks, which is the HBO show, was filming us that year in training camp. So it was all these things happening, right? So the whole city of Los Angeles was happy. NFL was back. We're in Los Angeles. We have all this time. We got a little money in our pocket. We're going out. You know, people recognizing us because we're on HBO that Sunday, every Sunday for 5 weeks.
Right.
You know, I got a 15-minute segment here and there. And you know, people are, you know, recognizing us and actually my first trip to LA coming off the plane with all the other rookies, we were on TMZ at the baggage claim. So all this is happening right now. I'm like, damn, this is what the NFL's like.
I'm
right?
famous.
Bro, like TMZ's filming us at baggage claim. We get in a van, we go, and we have the time of our lives for that whole off season during that summer of mini camp and OTAs, getting in the clubs free, like One Oak, bungalow in Santa Monica, getting anything we wanted, right? And then being on HBO, people from high school, people, I didn't even know I knew, calling me saying, yo, good job or great game.
Hey, what's
like
up,
that.
Bro? What's up, bro? Yeah. And so
fuck with me, bit, bro. And then it was all that, right? And I'm like, damn, this is the best thing in the world. And then fast forward to end of training camp, I get cut, put on practice squad. I know. Get put
on
practice squad.
Hold on. You sped through that. So you living a life.
Living a life. And not even on my pockets, just on clout.
Yeah,
just
yeah. Clout money. Right.
Training camp happens, and that's kind of when you chill out because you're doing preseason games. You're in the thick of things. It's hot. Practicing five times a week, and then you're playing that Thursday night. And then that last game, they decide if you're going to make the team, you're going to be on the 53, the guys who you see on Sunday, or you're going to be one of those 10 on the practice squad, or you're just not going to be in the NFL at all. Right. And so I made it to the spot where I wasn't on the 53, so I wasn't going to play that next Sunday, but I was going to be on the practice squad, meaning I'm still on the team, right. I'm just not playing on Sunday.
Right.
And so that was a big kick to me, because I was like, damn, like I thought I balled. I thought I did, I did my thing. And I feel like I did, but at the same time, shit happens, right?
Was it politics or was it?
I mean, it's always politics, and that's kind of what introduced me to the business of the NFL. And I'm glad that experience happened early because it opened my eyes. I wasn't like this lost puppy at 27 and then getting that experience and then my whole world being flipped upside down. Instead, I was on this high, 23 years old, my world got flipped upside down right now.
Right.
So now I'm younger. I have more time to think about it. I got, other opportunities, and I just got to think and survive for myself. I was going to tell you this practice squad story. My first week, I was on practice squad. A linebacker mistreatment because he had a hurt hamstring. They cut him. So in order to cut him and put him on the practice squad, somebody has to come off. It's a numbers game. You can't have more than the 53 or 10.
Right.
So he gets off the 53, gets on the 10. Well, then they take me off the 10 to make room for him, right? Mm-hmm. And I just put a lease down for an apartment.
Oh, so you got kicked off the team, period.
Got cut off the team.
Oh, I thought you were about to say they brought you up.
Damn. Bought an apartment that week right before because we had our first game of the season.
I'm
was
thinking he gonna get
fired. I'm thinking nice little plot twist. That Monday, that first game of the season wasn't a Sunday like the rest of the NFL. We played the 49ers in San Fran on a Monday night, so we had an extended day. So we had an extra day, no practice. So that's when all the rookies were buying or leasing their apartments, finding out where they're gonna live because you really get no break. So this was like our only opportunity. And I just made the team. I knew what my income was going to be for the whole season if I was on the team for 17 weeks. And
Do you mind putting numbers out?
Yeah. I was in Simi Valley. Our facility was in Thousand Oaks at Cal Lutheran because we didn't have a practice facility. We had home games at the L.A. Coliseum where the USC Trojans play. So we didn't have any home territory. So we had these makeshift facility with like these trailer parks and stuff like that, or these trailers put together at Cal Lutheran. We had a grass field connected to a parking lot where we practice, and that was kind of in the Thousand Oaks area. And so right next to it, the cheapest plot of land is like Simi Valley.
Right.
So that's like a 20-minute drive because Thousand Oaks is like the suburbs of L.A. That's like Malibu, so I couldn't afford that. And so $2,200 a month in Simi Valley. And I was, at the time, great apartment, two bedrooms, was just me by myself. Rented furniture from court. That was probably $500, $600 a pop.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So I'm $2,700 all in for 6 months, locked in.
Right.
And then 2 days later, Coach Fisher comes up to me and says, hey, we're gonna take you off the practice squad. We gotta make a spot for this linebacker, but stick around. You'll be here for, you'll be back in 2 or 3 weeks. So after that conversation, he looked me in my eyes as a man, and I went and signed my lease that I already been looking at this, I was apartment shopping for the 2 days before that. He looked me in my eyes, told me that, and I signed the lease the next day or that same day, thinking I'm going to be back in 2 or 3 weeks. So, I could take this $2,700 mortgage because I'm about to make $8,000 the day they sign me again.
Right.
I just got $8,000 from this first week, and it just didn't work out that way. I stayed around for 5 weeks living in this apartment.
Damn.
That phone wasn't picking up.
Bro, you know what that's like? That like when that shot tell you, look, don't go to sleep. I'm going to call you.
That's exactly what that is.
And you just stay up waiting for that bitch.
Yeah,
so like
exactly what it is.
So was you like
circling around the stadium like, what you doing?
Nah.
When did you realize?
This is the funny part. I was still pulling up to the facility for like 2 weeks. I'm not even on a team. I was pulling up to the facility for like 2 weeks, eating the meals in the cafeteria because I knew the schedule.
Oh, yes, sir.
And looking back on it, that was some crazy shit. Like, I'm a civilian at this point. That's some crazy shit. I'm walking in this.
But they let you in, though.
They let me in because, you know, I was on the team the day before, so the word doesn't spread for like 3 days, right? The whole team. Y'all still pulling up. I made sure I made every.
Is this on mic anywhere else?
No.
Look, nobody knows the story. It's exclusive.
It's some real shit, though. Nah, it's like you think of NFL and you don't think of shit like this, right?
Right.
I'm pulling up. I know. I got the schedule on my iPad. I got pulling up the breakfast. I'm pulling up the lunch. I'm pulling up the dinner. And after you know, everybody's done, they're going to meetings, and I'm hopping back in my car going home. Literally, just I'm sitting at the
crib. How good were the meals?
Yeah, that's like dropping out.
Yeah, I mean, they're professional chefs. Yep. So let's just, you know,
this was so
in the morning.
It's worth it.
This was so funny. I can imagine this nigga like, shh.
Boy, practice crazy, man.
Bro, it's crazy.
Practice crazy.
It's crazy thinking about it now. Like, damn. Like, take 2019 when I was on the Panthers. If somebody got cut and I still saw them in the building, I'd be like, yo, you're like low-key trespassing. You know what I'm saying? Like, yo, what are you this is like, you know, you could get. Dang. It's a criminal thing.
But just off of karma, you got to let him stay. Cause, like,
yeah,
you can't
no,
kick
no,
him
no.
Out.
I wouldn't say
yeah,
nothing.
Yeah,
I'm just
yeah.
in my head. I'm just thinking, like,
can't
yo, you're wild for doing this. But I was doing
just
that. Not knowing any better. No, I'm not saying I would say that.
We all did it. You know what I'm saying?
No, I wouldn't say that to that person, but in my head, I'd be thinking, like, damn, this nigga tripping.
Because you wouldn't know, like, are they about to come back and turn up?
Right.
Because they just got cut.
Exactly. How crazy. Think about getting cut from Amazon. Yeah. You're the lead engineer. If you came back to Amazon the next day, I would think you're about to blow the building up. Because you pissed. Yeah, so man, think about that. Think
Steve
about
Jobs.
Somebody. So,
Steve Jobs got
how much money would you scheduled to make? How much you would have made?
On practice squad, $8,000 a week for 17 weeks.
136.
That's the math?
Yeah.
Yeah. So
yeah, I got some mathematicians.
Yeah, so $8,000 a week for 17 weeks.
On 53, which you would have made?
Which is still good.
At rookie, 22
a week.
Which is, you know, three times the amount, but.
Yeah.
Yeah, 400.
400. 400,000. Okay. Yeah, you would have made some change.
Yeah, I mean, after taxes, you go home January 1st if your team doesn't make the playoffs. You got 5 months off of $250,000 in your bank account.
$250,000.
Right.
That's, you know what I'm saying? That's different than going home. And I still had a good amount of change. I had like $80,000 in my bank account, but that ain't $250,000.
All right, so you, I'm imagining you have your trespassing dinner.
Multiple times.
You get in the car and you fix in your mirror and you look yourself in the eye and say, you're better than this, Chubb.
I think what stopped me.
What happened? Let's get into the.
I think what stopped me was literally like after 2 weeks, I'm calling my agent. I'm like, yo, you hear back from the Rams yet? You know, they told me it'd be 2 weeks. I let 2 weeks go by and I still, you know, my agent didn't say anything. They didn't hit me up. And he said, nah, nothing. And then that's kind of when it clicked. Like, this is a business, right? Even though he told me I could be signed back in 2 weeks, I'm starting to learn shit, right? Like I said, I'm 23 and I just got cut. Off the high of my life, I'm kind of mentally in survival mode now, like thinking like, all right, well, what do I got to do? I'm adding expenses up. All right, I got $8,000 a month for that first week I was on the team. Well, now I can pay my rent for at least 4 months, 3 months maybe. Mm-hmm. I still got 3 months to play. So, you know what I'm saying? I'm just doing all this shit, right? Calculating, right. Making sure I'm straight. And I realized like, yo, like them niggas might not sign me back. You know, after actually having real talks with my agent,
right.
And asking him to, you know, tell me more besides the fact that, you know, they ain't picked up the phone yet.
Right.
I'm like, damn, well, should I be coming to this? You know, I am not really on the team. Like, I'm low-key tripping. So I stopped doing that, like, after 2 weeks and just kind of.
So when did you stop using that to get in the club? Like, hey, you
so
know
So that's
me?
The thing, though. That's
you know
the thing.
Me?
I never used the NFL card for anything as far as club, nightlife, girls.
Better than me.
But what the thing is, and none of us are females in here, but. They know. They could tell. If I walk in a club and I walk with somebody else who's 6'3", and he's not built like a basketball player, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. You could tell.
Yeah.
And we were on TV, so people recognize. I'm leaving week 4 of preseason. I'm leaving the bungalow, And people are like, yo, good shit, Chubb. Hey, I hope you make it.
See, I'm laughing because I know niggas who wasn't in the NFL, but they that size.
Yeah.
So when they all were like, one of our frat brothers was in the NFL, the girls think they all right. Played.
Right. Yeah, for sure. They all get that love. That's why niggas stay deep. Yeah.
All right, so
I handle the books.
Let's talk about, and I'm going somewhere with this, but this story is great. Yeah, I'm not gonna lie, I'm loving this shit. Let's get to Panthers. How do we get there? Because that's on the other side.
Yeah,
of the
world. So after week five of the season, so four weeks of not being on the Rams, I'm still in L.A. My agent calls me, says Detroit wants to work you out. Fly to Detroit the next day. They sign me on the spot. Stay in Detroit for the rest of the season. And then that goes into 2017.
You practice, like, what are you?
Practice squad. Just picking me up, signing me to have me for depth, and just in case anybody else gets hurt, then I'll get elevated. And so, healthy linebacker crew, that parlays into next season, 2017.
How was Detroit? You know, you're in a different city now, like.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. It was the opposite end of the spectrum.
Right.
I go from Thousand Oaks, L.A., West Hollywood
to
Detroit. And nothing against Detroit. I mean, I know a lot of our people live up in Detroit. Like, you look up in Detroit, it's always, you know what I'm saying? It's always gray. It's, you know, it's cold. Detroit is Detroit, bro. Yeah.
It's so blue cold in the D.
You know what I'm saying? So it's a whole world of a difference. You know, it's raining. You got weather. L.A. It never rained. We had all our shit outdoors. No roofs on our shit. Like, none of our locker rooms had roofs on, and our weight rooms outside in a tent because it just didn't rain. Like, Detroit, you had the snow, you had, you know, all this muggy weather. It was always, you know, it was low-key depressing.
You still getting eight a week with them?
Yep, same price. And then that parlays into 2017. Go through that whole off-season cycle again, so mini camp, and then I tear my ACL. So I got hurt. So before I even get in the season, get hurt. And then
at practice?
At practice, first day of practice, OTA, so non-contact. We're just in helmets and shoulders, helmets and jerseys.
Man. That meant you were really in your bag. Yeah. Like, you were trying to show out.
And it was
that happened
with
me. I was racing a drone. That shit happened to me.
For real?
Yeah.
Dumbass nigga.
So I feel you. I can relate to that shit.
Yeah.
Go back to the crates.
And so I tore my ACL, but I mean, I was a blessing and a curse, right? That was me being on injured reserve, which is the list you're on when you're on the team. But you're hurt, so you're not playing that year, but nobody else can take you off that team, right? So how Detroit took me from the Rams, because I was basically a free agent. When you're on injured reserve, nobody can touch you. You're basically on the team. You're just not playing because obviously you're hurt, but you get paid like you're playing.
Mm.
So then, so I'm, you know, May 20, 2017, I'm hurt. I get surgery July 7th. That's a 9-month recovery. I missed the whole season, but I'm on injured reserve. I get 17 checks for $32,000, you know, gross. I net it probably 16 a week. But that was, you know, one of my largest paydays.
Right.
You know, 16 times 17, and then I didn't touch anything. I got they let me go back home and rehab. I rehabbed at Emory. So I'm not paying for an apartment. I'm living with my parents. You know, I have my own car, so I'm not renting cars. I'm eating home-cooked meals. So a lot of this shit, I'm just pocketing.
Oh, yeah, so you know,
I can't run or go to the club, so I'm not spending money on club. I'm, you know, I can't do shit, so I'm not like wasting
shit,
money. You know what
that
I'm
shit really don't work. Like, you know, I'm in the NFL, but I live with my mama right now. You know what I mean?
And so,
but I'm still paid.
So, you know, that was a blessing in disguise for me, because one, you know, financially it helped me, but two, it goes back to, you know, facing reality and facing the business early on. Like, I got wake-up calls. I got to see the light at the end of the tunnel. What if I don't come back from this knee surgery? What if, you know, they don't sign me back after my injury? What if this is the end? Then I had to start preparing for life after football. So I started networking. I started meeting with Wake Forest alums in the Atlanta area. I started doing stuff like externships and shit with the NFLPA, stuff to build my business acumen. So when it is all said and done, I'll at least fall on my feet, right? You know, some people don't do anything. They focus on just being the best football player, best basketball player.
Better and shit.
Yeah, which is cool because you get paid to do it. But at the same time, like, you got to have a balance, because you focus on that shit and then you're done playing, especially football, high contact sport. Say you play for 10 years, which is a long career. You play for 10 years, you're 32. You got 40 years before you can retire, realistically, right?
Right.
Even if you have all the money in the world, say you have a Julio Jones career. I stopped playing at 32. I got $70 million in the bank. You still work. You're my best friend. You still working.
Right.
My brother going to 9 to 5 or working.
Right.
my, you know, I can't call nobody and pull up on a Tuesday at 2 o'clock. You know what I'm saying? So now I'm just at the crib with a bunch of space and no opportunities.
I seen my cousin do that. My cousin, when he came home from the NFL, like, he played for a while, and he just like a, his wife was a doctor at Emory, mm-hmm. so, you know, she got plenty of money. He done made a little money.
Yeah,
he was just at the house. Like, he was just the best Call of Duty dad I ever met.
Like, well, if COVID taught him anything, like, niggas can't do that forever. That's not sustainable.
Yeah, like,
I don't care if you got $100 million. If you think about all these niggas, like, you think of an entrepreneur who sold his company for $200 million or $100 million, and then they go start another company or they go work for Amazon. Like, why are they still working?
Mm-hmm.
Nigga, because you would literally drive yourself crazy.
Yeah,
because you don't. You know what I'm saying? I don't care how much money you got, how nice your house is. After 10 days, that shit gets old.
Right.
And that's what I realized too. I was rehabbing at Emory. I was working rehabbing from 7 to 9 in the morning. I would come home at 9:30 in the morning. Parents are gone at work. Nobody else is home, and I'm bored out of my mind. I'm like, yo, this can't be what my life is like if football was to stop. And that's kind of what helped motivate me to get my shit going business wise and networking and going to the gathering spot, you know, doing all the shit I was doing.
Get us to the Panthers.
2018. So 2017, tear my ACL. 2018, come back. They clear me from a physical, so meaning I'm physically able to go, even though my knee was still, like, in the recovery phase. That fast forwards to them clearing me and then waving me, and then Panthers picked me up, and then I played for the Panthers for 2 years, nice. 18 and 19.
So were you starting at the Panthers, or you was on the practice? How was that?
2018, I didn't start. I played. I was just a special teams guy. And then 2019, got hurt again. So I did the whole injured reserve thing where, yeah, you know, getting paid not to play.
And that's where I met you.
Yeah.
Insert where we met.
Yeah.
Boom. All right.
2019, that January, February of 2019. Yeah. That's insert where we met.
Crazy. You done had a ride, bro.
Yeah, I had a ride. And you know, it could have been way better. It could have been all this. You know, I could have been drafted second, third round where I thought I should have been drafted. I could have been, you know, this guy who plays 10, 15 years, but I don't think when it was all said and done, my life would be where it's going to be when it's all said and done right now, you know?
So can we now go back to the genesis, man? You in high school, man. How did you decide what college you wanted to go to?
The market decided for me. So I went into my senior year with no offers.
Mm.
Played my senior season. Started picking up offers here and there, and double A schools, but nothing wrong with that. But it's not, you know, it's not ACC. Right. So I got Georgia Southern, I got Chattanooga, I got Furman, I got, you know, all these SoCon schools. And then 3 days, I'm committed to App State, which last won a championship in 2009. This is 2011. So they're fresh off of, you know, still being a nationally powerhouse school, but on a double A level. I commit to them 3 days before signing day. So signing day is on a Wednesday. Thursday, Wake Forest comes to my school. A linebacker that was committed to Wake Forest decommitted and went to Georgia Tech. Wake Forest coach comes to my school. They pull me out of class. He says, hey, a linebacker just decommitted. I can't guarantee you a scholarship, but come check out the campus this weekend. So went Friday, Saturday, Sunday for my official visit to Wake Forest. Still committed to App State. They offer me that Sunday as I'm leaving to come back to Atlanta. I commit on the spot. 3 days later, I signed my name to Wake Forest. Mm-hmm. And that's how I got to Wake.
Just real quick, was the NFL always your dream? Or is that something that just kind of like happened? Because it sounds like this is starting to be a kind of rhythm almost. It's like it kind of almost didn't happen, yeah, but then it happened. So it's like, was that something that you wanted to happen? Or it just was,
yeah,
you kept stumbling into
it? I'm glad you pointed out that rhythm. That's kind of the story of my life, right? Like, underdog. You know, never really given anything, had to work for it. And even if I was looked over or under recruited or undrafted, I had to make a way out of no way. But NFL was always my dream. My dad played in the NFL. He played at University of Georgia. So growing up, you know, they have an office like this. Him and my parents had an office. This whole wallpaper is Georgia Bulldog cartoon characters. It's his jersey, you know, the size of this from his Gator Bowl victory versus Michigan State. I see pictures of him on the shelves, shit like that. So I knew he played in the NFL. I wanted to be like him, right? He's the male figure in my life.
Right.
I'm a male. That's who I grew up aspiring to be. So, yeah, I wanted to go to the NFL.
So you can you talk about some of your colleagues, man, when their decision was to go to school, like people, cats you knew when they were going to college? Like, because it sounds like you grew up with two parents.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? It's a different vibe. A lot of guys you see that play ball, They probably didn't have two parent home, like you, NFL with their dream, but not because they were aspiring to be the dad, but they were just aspiring to be in the league. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to take care of my mama.
Yeah, one of my boys, he actually, you know, single parent household, raised by his mom. I went to South Carolina junior day, University of South Carolina, their junior day. This 2010, South Carolina is one of the best teams in the world. You know, they're beating Georgia. They're beating Alabama's. They got Stephon Gilmore. They got all these dogs at South Carolina, one of the best teams in the country. Dang. Alshon Jeffery.
Dang. Dang. All right, Keith. All right.
And we go to their junior day just because, you know, Columbia is probably a two-hour drive from here. And so my homeboy, you know, his mom had to work on the weekends and stuff, providing for the house. He's like, yo, can I ride with you and your mom to South Carolina so we can both go to junior day? And so we go to South Carolina. My mom drives. We're in the car for 2 hours. We hop out the car. As soon as we hit the pavement, coach comes up to him. Spurrier, hey, come here. Takes him to the back office. Doesn't even acknowledge me, which is fine. I don't care, but doesn't even acknowledge me. Takes him to the back office. I see him 25 minutes later. He's like, bruh, I just got my first scholarship offer.
Like, nigga, you fucking rode with me.
I'm like, damn.
Hey, look, it's like, bro, I'm not taking you to the party. And you going to get some pussy
right.
And not say it ain't fun if the homie can't get right. Nothing, bro. Right. Like,
this right. The girl I can't. Right. Right.
Right. Or right, even right. Ask where your friend at for the homie, right? Like, you know what I mean?
So
I came with Chubb, you know?
Man, and there's no, and it's no fault of his own, right? It's not,
imagine you know. That ride home.
I don't remember the ride home. Yeah. Hey.
Look. Quiet, I was like, this motherfucker. Man. I would hit that nigga like, hey, my mama said you got to get us some gas.
you got that.
So, I mean, just to you know, your point, my colleagues, right? That was one kid who didn't grow in the same household as me, and that's kind of how he chose his college. He ended up having a bunch of offers, but he went to South Carolina. Another one went to Georgia Tech. He was a highly recruited guy, but he went because his older brother went to Georgia Tech. So it was just kind of like keeping it in their family. Another guy went to... Both of them went to South Carolina. So, you know, a lot of guys around me had offers. We were on the same teams, but I'm not, you know, getting the looks. And it's partly because of the story I told you earlier. I'm playing DN because that's where the team needed me at.
Right.
You know, that's where we were best positioned to be successful because we already had linebackers. We had a guy who could do linebacker good enough for us to win games. We didn't have a DN that could, you know, set the edge and sat the quarterback and stuff like that. So at 6 feet, South Carolina isn't looking at me as a DN. They're looking at me as a linebacker because their linebackers are this size. So it was one of those moments. But
so now you in college, you doing your thing, you playing with some cats from all over the world. That's one thing I love about the NFL, man. It's just the process of elimination.
Yeah.
High school is the best cats in your community. You know what I'm saying? Like, college is the best cats in the country. You know what I'm saying? NFL is the best cats in the fucking world.
Mm-hmm.
Like, when you think about that shit, like, college, they could get niggas from anywhere, and you made the team. So, they just came down with a new ruling. People should get paid. College students can now get paid in college.
Huge.
Can you tell any broke stories as a college student playing ball, whether it was you or somebody you know, and just the struggle of, one, not only playing ball, but knowing that you are the back of an engine that is making so much money for that institution.
Yeah, I mean, I got a lot, right? We got opportunities where we got meal swipes, but if you ration it out, the meal swipes are like two meals a day for, you know, every business day, right? And so football players, you trying to get big, your body's still developing.
You gotta eat every day.
Eat every day. You eat three meals, right? You're not eating... You know, lunch and dinner.
You're not a fucking vegan.
Exactly. You're eating every day. So, you know, meal spikes would run up. I had to go get me a George Foreman grill. I'm in a dorm room the size of this room, right? It's a bed, and two desks, right? So it's nothing crazy. The closet is like that.
No, this room is fucking big. No, this is just the angle.
No. The room is big.
I can't see. It's the angle.
The room is big, but put two twin XL beds in here side by side. Yeah. Skinny ass walkway. And it's
I remember them dorm rooms.
Dorm room days.
They was twin XL, though. They wasn't just the regular twin. You had to go get the sheets for the twin XL.
You got the regular twin, you like, fuck.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Now, this room, yeah, but I mean, Would you live
smoking
in
that bitch out with a George Foreman?
Bro,
hey, with some incense.
Bro, I was going to Walmart getting chicken thighs and literally picking George Foreman's on my desk next to my laptop. Next to where I put my fucking head at night.
Absolutely.
Like, that's, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's small. And I'm fucking putting Tupperware.
Eat fucking good.
Trying to eat fucking good because I couldn't eat lunch every day if I wanted to, you know, use all my fucking meal swipes.
Were there ever an opportunity where you were like, fuck, but I could get paid?
Yeah, for sure.
Like, what were they?
They sold my jersey. Mm. I'm number 48. You think of jersey sales, right? You think when I sell a jersey, I'm selling the quarterback, wide receiver, running back, maybe the cornerback. Those are single-digit numbers. They're selling seven, the Vicks. They're selling twos. They're selling, you know, the Johnny Manziels. They're selling whatever it may be. They're not selling 48s.
Right.
I was just that dude that weight, right? And they sold 48s going into my senior year. We had a new jersey, new uniform combo. They sold 48s in the bookstore, on the campus store. If you wanted to wait for his jersey, because obviously you didn't have our names on the back, it was a number 48 jersey. And so everybody's buying these jerseys.
Did you know the stats? Did they tell y'all, like, the number, like, oh, your jersey.
Oh, they would never do that. Yeah. No. Because then, you know, the machine would fight back.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we would fight the machine, I mean.
Right.
And so.
But you know.
But I'm playing Clemson, and everybody who's in black has 48 on their chest, right?
Right.
I'm playing Florida State, and people who are traveling, I know they're a Wake fan because I see the 48 in gold. So it was obvious. I'm going to frat parties, and we're day partying, and guys are coming straight from the 12 o'clock game to a frat house at 3 p.m., 4 p.m., with 48 jerseys on, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's, if you wanted to wear the jersey or wear a weight jersey, that's the jersey you had to buy.
So imagine if you could have sold your own custom exclusive t-shirt, like anything. Like, I meant, like, what would it have done for you? Like,
no, I mean, definitely would have helped. It would have saved nights from drinking Burnett's. You know what Burnett's is? It's like $9 for a half gallon of alcohol. Like, it's like the bottom of
gasoline.
The bed. That's it's gasoline. Burnett's. Google it. Burnett's. Yeah. We were drinking Burnett's.
All the bullshit flavors.
Bro, it's like, yep, it's like alcohol syrup. If I drank Burnett's right now, I might not wake up.
Oh, God.
That's how, like, you know, it's just pure alcohol.
So, was it, have y'all ever had, like, I mean, when you were playing, when you, because I feel like this is what I call an Obama conversation. For years, we had the Obama conversation. But can you imagine if it was the black president? You know what I'm saying? Dun, 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 dun. You know, like we said, all the comedians would say, what if we had a black president? Like, there's always those conversations, what if?
Yep.
Did y'all have the what if we could get paid conversation in college?
100%.
What were some of those?
Wake Forest is, the demographics of Wake Forest, it costs $60,000 a year in tuition, right? So guys, kids that are going to Wake Forest are kids from boarding schools up north, northeast boarding schools, people who come from generational wealth, generational money, right? So one of the girls I was talking to my freshman year, her roommate is the daughter of the owner of the Toronto Raptors. She named the Toronto Raptors the Raptors, right? So the American Express, his granddaughter, went to Wake Forest. That's the type of people I'm around. One of the Hawks owners is our biggest alum, right? Mitch Shaw, he owns the Hawks and has one of the biggest private equity firms. I say all that to say the alums and the money that circulates Wake, it's a private school.
Right.
You know, government doesn't give them money. And so they make their money through tuition and people donating. So donors, you know, we have these donor meetings every spring game. Before the spring game, that Friday night, we sit up in the field house right in front of the stadium, and we eat with all these alums and donors who pay for our scholarships. Imagine if NIL was in effect. Now I could go eat Ruth Chris with that dude. Now I can go, you know,
right,
to his lake house on Lake Norman and celebrate the game-winning touchdown we just had, right? Or stuff like that. And then you get handshakes. You get, you know, being able to have a car, being able to even – Wake Forest is like a neighborhood, right? It's gated community. You had to park on campus if you had a car, freshmen, sophomores, and it was like $95 a month. Mm. And these are kids, you know, think about me. I'm going to school for free. You telling me I got to pay $95 just to have my car so I could go to Walmart and get my chicken thighs? You know what I'm saying? Or
on my George Foreman fucking right, grill.
My George Foreman grill or my fan to circulate because I was sweating bullets that night because the AC didn't work. So being able to have opportunities like that, being able to say, yo, everybody in the stadium has them on jersey, but I can't go, you know, make money off that. I'm in the NCAA football game. The last year was my junior year of the NCAA football game. I'm in it three times, right, and I've not seen anything from it. You know how much you make in the NFL for being a Madden? $50,000 a year.
Damn.
You ain't, hey, you didn't sit in no creative meeting. You didn't sit in no design meeting. You didn't do no coding.
And
you get a $50,000 check at the beginning of the season every year just because your name's in Madden.
That's also a ripoff, though, but it's a good check, but it's a good check.
Yeah, it's a, I mean, yeah.
So, So now, are we doing that with? Because I always thought about that about college football game. Is it the same thing now? Are they getting that check?
Oh no, there's just the fact that that game is even allowed to be made again is what they're getting. Because now they can put the last name on the back of the player's jersey. Now the player can actually look like the player in real life, like it does in Madden. But they're not getting a check from that. No, they're getting checks from opportunities like, hey, the local car wash and, you know,
but
Boise, Idaho wants to.
But can I, like, but now, can I sue for my likeness now? Like I got to ask, that's a law conversation. Speaking of, commercial break, every Thursday, check out That's Law, attorney Durante Partridge, newest show on the Just Eldredge Media podcast. Y'all will definitely enjoy that. It goes down every week. Check it out. Subscribe, like, share with a friend. Giving free game for all creatives and entrepreneurs. That's Law. And we're back. So I wonder how that worked. That's a question I'm gonna ask later. So talk about the ruling. You know, I mean, I know you probably. What do you yep. like? Get a one. Catch people up that don't know what the ruling is, mm-hmm. and then what does this actually mean?
Yeah. So name, image, likeness, NIL basically is allowing players to profit off their name, their image, and their likeness of being a NCAA football player, volleyball player, basketball player, swimmer, whatever it may be, whatever their sport is. So what that means is, so prior to this law, players couldn't accept money as compensation for them being the brands they are, the athletes they are, the money they bring to these schools. So you think about a Clemson University, right? That football team is probably bringing $2 million a week every home game in ticket sales and concession stand sales to Clemson University. Those players see none of it. But what they tell you is, oh, well, you're getting a $15,000 scholarship for free. You're getting an education for free.
Right.
You know, Duke men's basketball or Kentucky men's basketball. Their coach is making Calipari's making like $9 million a year.
Bro, when you see NFL coaches leaving the NFL to go coach college ball,
yeah,
like, come on, dog.
It's at least 5 to 10 college coaches that make more than NFL coaches, like Dabo, Jim Harbaugh, Saban.
Saban at
Ohio State, but allowing players to monetize off their likeness, their name, their image. So what that allows them to do is sell t-shirts with their name on it, sell those big ephemeral moments that, you know, I caught the Hail Mary versus Georgia. If I'm Josh Dobbs, now I could go market that and trademark that and make money off of it instead of just getting a pat on the back and a hot dog at the end of the game from the local catering company, right? So being able to monetize and really incentivize athletes and really pay them back the compensation they bring to that school in a way that at least makes it a fair market type of deal, a fair labor market at least.
So is this going to be a distraction from the game or is it going to be an enhancer to the game?
I think it'll be an enhancer. It'll decrease the disparity in college football, right? So you think about college football, we see the top four college playoff teams every year is some iteration of Clemson, Georgia, Ohio State, Oklahoma, Alabama, right? Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So now I can say, hey, Wake Forest, smallest Power 5 school in the country, but you could get this donor who makes $20 million a year in private equity. He could give you a $5,000 stipend now. So now if I'm a North Carolina recruit and I'm deciding between Clemson, Georgia, Wake Forest, or UNC, why wouldn't I go to Wake Forest? I'm still going to play those guys. I'm still going to play at the highest competition. Oh, and I'm going to get a great education on top of it. And I'm going to be the biggest fish in the smallest pond ever. My compensation is only immense, right? Versus going to Clemson and being the 10th five-star on the team and not even knowing if you're going to make the team or make the starting roster or not because they're bringing in guys to take your spot every year.
So what is – you got a question?
Well, I was going to ask, do we know if the deal – goes the other way too. So you in college, so now you can get paid, right? Can you sign your boy up, who's a business major now, to be your manager to handle these deals?
And yeah, how so can now,
I, you know, yeah, now so, can we so, start this at a small?
So level? Maverick, the LeBron and Maverick relationship can start in fucking high school.
Exactly,
like literally. And what's so funny? I almost want to call Draco right now because. I had a partner, Draco. We knew he was going to the league. Mm-hmm. He was fucking amazing. And I signed him as an athlete on a napkin at lunch. Like, because I knew this business shit was going to be me.
That's some Eldredge shit.
Yeah, I just knew this thing was going to be my, I knew this thing was going to be my talent. But now, you got to think about how strategic you can be as a high school student. You know what I'm saying? As a high school student now, I'm looking at the playing field like, boom, who's the alumni? You know,
exactly.
Who's the, you know, it's so much shit. Like, you almost got to begin to set up your brand as a high school student and carry that shit over to your college career.
But where's the downside to this? Like, what's the, because
here, here's,
you know,
the downside.
They don't legalize anything without having a plan already. You know what I mean?
So the, first of all, I feel like the downside comes with the lack of education.
Yeah, knowledge.
The lack of business acumen. You know,
the downside is going to be these 360 deals a lot of people are signing, not knowing they're signing it.
In high school. You know what I'm saying? I'm a high school student.
And like that same example, somebody saw my talent, not saying he was doing this, but somebody, some snake, saw my talent, hopped on me early. Now I'm signed to this dude for the next 15 years of my life, not even knowing it.
Because he was buying me J's. Because
he was buying me J's and made it seem all friendly at the nascent stage when I wasn't making money.
Yeah.
Now I signed my first professional contract, and I'm like, damn, I didn't even read this, but 5% goes to this dude.
So there's now, do these private schools and these AAU leagues, do they become money deals?
Oh, AAU is about to, like, they about to win more than anybody, in my opinion.
I mean, they already were.
Yeah, they already were, but now, like, first of all, a little shout out and nod to LeVar Ball, because he set the stage for all of this shit.
Damn. And he's really about to take off.
Like,
and he lived it. I mean, he lived his word.
Yeah. Like, that nigga lived this shit. Didn't my boy get Rookie of the Year?
Rookie of the Year.
Yep.
Come on, dog. Like, LeVar Ball was the trendsetter in all of this as far as knowing your worth. So I think now what has to happen, these mothers have to really begin to protect their babies.
Yeah. Because I was going to say, because of the lack of knowledge and education, it's the wild, wild west right now. Everybody's figuring shit out, right? It's the first of its kind. It's going to be people taking advantage of it, people getting exploited. And that's when, like I was saying, those 360 deals are going to happen. But being able to educate and put yourself in the best company. Because everybody in a suit's going to look like a trustworthy guy or gal. But then you put this into perspective 5 years from now. What did I get myself into? You know what I'm saying?
Can you read the six? I sent you an article that it was like 16 people that got paid. Like, I just want to know some. It's 16 athletes getting paid under the new NCAA.
Yeah, so one of them that saw Bo Nix from Auburn, he signed a deal with Milo Sweet Tea. You know what I'm saying? So that's what's up. I just seen
Big Bo. That's a country. He a big country boy. You know what I'm saying? Like Auburn, Georgia.
The Cavender Twins and Boost Mobile, they said they signed the first deal for collegiate NIL history on the Icon Source Marketplace. And they're two basketball players. So
Master P signed getting $2 million. He signed a $2 million deal. You got the Miami quarterback signed $20,000, you know.
Marshall Football, Will Omer, he signed a deal. So, yeah.
And when you ask how will it affect for the good of college football, like I said, it'll limit that disparity. It's schools right now that these rich alums and donors are setting up fake companies to say, hey, you have an endorsement with my company, and my company can pay you $100,000.
Yeah, Dante Allen from Kentucky men basketball, he's about to start doing his own merch. So he has shirts and hoodies.
Yeah, see, that's what I want. I want to see more independent
personal brand.
Like, so for me, I got
to. One more. Let me cut you off. We got Antoine Owens. He signed a deal with Three Kings Grooming. It's a black-owned hair care
product. Oh, that's dope.
So
I saw that.
Jackson State.
Hey, turn me up. I got to call this guy.
Where them twins at?
Like I was saying, I do feel like this ruling is the advantage that HBCUs needed to make their schools more attractive.
And I agree with that.
Like,
and it helps with that sacrifice and making that movement that we just talked about. How do you, who does that? How do you start that?
Because what happens is if I'm a dope ass high school student, I have 4 years of struggle before me and my mama make it.
Mm-hmm.
Now my mama's straight. As soon as I leave high school, hell, in high school, my mama could be straight.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So now I'm making decisions based off of my heart, not my need. You know what I mean? Like,
I agree with that. I think that's a great conclusion of that new ruling, the way to see that. I love that.
Yeah, so it's like, because I used to think about NFL, I used to think about college players. Everybody's not going to the league.
Exactly.
And they know that. But everybody on that team busting their ass and killing their body. Like, I was talking to my cousin who played in the league. And a lot of people in my family go to the league. We got to hit. Like, in my family, you either going to play ball, be an entertainer, start a business. Like, it's like three things you going to do. And my cousin Lee, I used to ask him, nigga, I'm like, bro, like, what's the difference? He like, man, shit. My cousin said, man, they hit hard in college. They hit hard in the NFL. Like, he like, niggas just hit, like, these just, he said, in the college, you got to realize this niggas that are hungry trying to get to the league. So they're trying to fucking kill your ass. Now, you got niggas in the league that's getting paid millions to kill your ass. But he said it was a different level of passion in college. So saying that to say, think about them niggas that went hard and they got not a dime. They play every year alongside Reggie Bush, every year alongside, I mean, you named the athlete, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that nigga just went home. And the reader, like you said it, the writing is on the wall. I just don't want to fucking read it.
Right.
And then if you went to a big school and you started, they take over your life. You really ain't thinking about no books.
You're the perfect one.
Now, I was going to say Maurice Claret, Ohio State running back.
Yep.
Man, I seen this man in Kroger one time. Swear, food stamps and all.
Mm-hmm.
And this was the biggest name in college football for a minute. You remember Maurice Claret?
One of the biggest college running backs at Ohio State ever.
Man, huge. And he went tried to play ball up in Canada. And
I'm so glad you're here because that nigga might want to swear we just got down with disagreeing with him because I didn't know that nigga name.
You don't know him either, Keith?
For real. Hey, look, that was, I'm so glad this nigga.
No, they had a ESPN 30 for 30 and that put me on him.
Maurice, he has a
30
for
30. And I lived in Columbus, so that's why I was hip to him. But I'm just saying, like, he had – in
hometown
college,
hero.
He was not even that, bro. It was bigger than that. I don't think he was from Columbus. I think
when he from Youngstown,
he might have been.
He's from
Ohio somewhere. Yeah. But he definitely was like a big deal. And they was talking about NFL projections, all of these things.
Yeah.
Like
he was that guy.
He got in a little bit of trouble and
ended up going to Youngstown State. Yeah,
Youngstown State. There you go.
And I challenge you on that point. Everybody's not going to make the professional league, right? NBA, NFL, baseball, whatever. But I don't think they all know that. I think everybody thinks they're going to make it.
You think so?
Yeah, hell yeah. I agree,
yes.
I
so
agree.
You were saying like everybody wants to go to the NFL, but yeah. Everybody wants to go to the NFL, but they don't think they're some know they're not going. Everybody thinks they're going to go.
They could pinpoint right where. Oh, if such and such didn't fail me,
right.
Or such and such would have let me play that one game, I would have been recruited,
right.
And I would have been in the
right.
Damn. Like everybody.
That's my best.
That speaks more to the machine of how they have made millions off the backs of these boys. Like, it's
and
okay.
That's why they end up with nothing because they, like I said, with that same NFL example, you're hyper focused, you sacrifice everything in your life for, especially in college. Sacrifice education, sacrifice social life to do this one thing. It doesn't happen for you. Now you're left with nothing. I don't know what I like. I don't know what I'm interested in. I don't know what I'm good at. I don't know what I'm bad at. And now I'm competing with guys who've been planning for this their whole college career because they were, you know, math majors or biochem majors. And now I'm competing with that 22-year-old for the same job. And, you know, we're sounding like two different people in the interview. Yeah.
I mean,
I'm going to execute the play.
I'm going to execute the play.
I'm an athlete. I mean, I I'm a dad.
Leadership.
Yeah.
Leadership.
I think on my feet. Yeah. I think on my feet. And why this, you know what I'm saying? This nigga's giving financial projections for the fucking Fortune 500 company that CEO can't even fucking do.
It's a difference.
you know what I'm saying?
Difference, man.
And so, I mean, I think to your conclusion, bro, the NIL is huge.
So how does this, I know in the beginning, I want to talk about this before we go. You're a venture capitalist now.
Yes, sir.
Talk about that. What you doing, and does this affect you and your business anyway?
Not necessarily, because for venture capital, it's a high risk, high reward. And so to even access this asset class, your check size has to be a certain size, right? But what it does
What's
do,
a certain size?
I mean, so you're investing in the next Facebook or the next Uber or the next Airbnb, hopefully, right? So you're buying 20% of the company. If this valued at $20 million, 20% is $2 million, right? So either you're exactly. Your
do y'all firm, do y'all don't think y'all don't think Reggie Bush could have got $2 million with this new rule?
$2 million? $2 million is a lot of money,
yeah, bro. $2 million. Reggie Bush to like selling what?
Yeah,
bro.
Merch.
Bro. Reggie Bush was fucking crazy, bro. Like that nigga was.
I don't think you're getting $2 million, but I think he deserves a percent. Like Chubb was saying, the machine is already in place. You cut me my percentage. Yeah. But for him to have his own machine, I don't
two
know.
Mil? Because when you say selling merch, he might gross $2 million. But I mean,
yeah, but I'm just talking about with every like if you just had a nigga working for you.
But even that, bro. If he, say he did get $2 million, he's gonna give all $2 million to one company that might no, that just, has a 10%.
I'm just throwing out projection. Like yeah. I just don't think. Maybe I'm overthinking what these college players really could be making out here.
$2 million is a lot, but was Reggie Bush the biggest college player?
No, I'm just saying Reggie because I like.
But Reggie, no, Reggie did get $200,000. That's why he lost his Heisman Trophy. Yeah, they bought him a $200,000 house.
Who was the biggest college player ever?
Johnny Manziel.
Can he get
as far as monetization? Johnny Manziel.
Can he get two? You think he can get $2 million?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, so then that means it's possible. Building a brand is more important than talent.
Yeah,
but Reggie Bush wasn't around with Instagram,
right? And like, Johnny Manziel was a brand. He was bigger than a football star.
What's the name? White privilege, man. I feel like Tim Tebow could get to that nigga can get anything, bro.
He probably could have because Tebow he had that religious
base. Tim Tebow get whatever the fuck he wants.
He could have sold Bibles. Yeah. And he would have.
This nigga was winning.
Tim Tebow could get whatever the fuck he wanted.
But the Ball brothers, though, they would have cashed out.
No, I don't think so.
Well, they didn't go to college. Mello didn't go to college.
They wouldn't have cashed out because the establishment didn't like Ball. So, like, it was, like, a lot of shit to try to make sure them niggas just didn't win.
Yeah, it was a couple players that could have cashed out, though, because it was a couple big NCAA, like, basketball players.
But I just wanted to make sure, like, there is a real ceiling for some real money.
JJ Redick.
Yeah, that's all I want to say.
All
right. All
them Duke boys.
We can get to it. But let's talk about what you're doing now.
All of them.
Yeah, so I have a VC fund. We raise money, invest in multiple companies, diversify, and try to get a home run, right? Venture capital is strikeout or home run. That's why I said that 10%, 20% chance of success is very risky. But at the same time, because it's so risky, your returns outweigh that risk, right, if you do it right. So if you invest in Facebook when it's just a social media site on the Harvard campus, and now Facebook, it is what it is today, a $1 trillion company. That $100,000 investment is a $130 million paycheck. You know what I'm saying? Or not even Facebook. You could do Spendify or any other company you want to think of.
Just Eldredge Media, right?
And when you have that
fuck with me, bit, bro.
Fuck with me, bit, bro. But when you have that liquidity event, that's when those returns come. And that's when your investors and those people who trusted in you and believed in your idea, your product at an early nascent stage when you didn't have all the revenue or you didn't have all these customers, they get rewarded, right? So being able to do that, and what I'm doing right now, I'm building a bridge. Venture capital, 0.6, we were just talking about diversity, 0.64% of black women as founders receive venture capital funding.
Less than one.
2% of men, black men, receive venture capital funding. So when you think about the community and putting generational wealth back into the hands of ourselves, we got to have people who look like me on the opposite end of the table who are distributing that capital.
Right, and check.
Because I got to take a chance on Spendify. I got to take a chance on Calendly. I got to take a chance just on Park Pit, on Just Eldredge Media.
Man,
I got to take. No, I just say Spendify because I remember you having a startup, but
right.
You know, just being able to take a chance on these black entrepreneurs who, on average, Coffin Fellows did a study, on average, received 30% higher returns than all white founding teams. So if I'm a diversified, ethnically diversified team, I receive 30% higher returns, and it's not because no special magic sauce. It's just I understand different pain points, right? You understand different pain points than that white man in, you know, Sacramento, California does.
Right.
You understand different pain points in your community than the person in fucking New York proper, right?
Right.
Or Sag Harbor, right? It's just you understand more things, and you put those diversified experiences and mindsets together in founders. These pain points that solve community problems, solve societal problems, that some people don't understand, but these are the people with the money that, you know, they lose out.
So me and my uh, my cousin Troy, we both played football.
Mm-hmm.
But we say business was the closest thing we're ever going to get to football again. You got a playbook. You got to build a team. You got to execute. Yeah. You got a championship. You feel the same way?
100%. And that's why I think we're positioned the way we are as athlete-led VC firm to win, right? Because we lose more than we win. As an athlete, you lose more than you win. How do you get up the next day and try to win again, even after you lost three in a row, after you lost and you're not on a good team? Or, you know, thinking about football, right? You watch film every day in practice, before practice or after practice, however your schedule is. You watch film. And in those film sessions, you just get criticized. They're not telling you how good you look. They're not telling you how great you are. They're telling you how bad you looked on this play. Yeah. How slow you were. You know what I'm saying? Like, how can you be better, right? So you internalize that and then try to put that into production the following day in less than a 24-hour time span. Think about a founder. Think about anybody else. That's what business is, right? Being able to roll with the punches, be resilient, be adaptable, be accountable, be disciplined on time, things like that, and be a leader, because you got to be able to lead a team. A lot of great companies fall apart because the founders just can't get along with each other.
Hold it together.
Because I'm the number one co-founder. No, you're the number, you know what I'm saying? You're the number two. You listen, you know what I'm saying?
Stupid ass shit.
Somebody has to lead.
Right.
And a good athlete, a good leader understands, hey, he might be better than me in this. She might be better than me in this aspect. Let me shut up and let her take over. And let me delegate certain things to myself that I'm good at, and she will understand that, or he will understand that, and they will let me take over when that comes.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So
that's what's up, man. What's the name of the company?
Captain Partners.
How can they find you?
On Instagram at Captain Partners, CaptainPartners.com, and then on Twitter, CAPTN Partners. And so we're investing in, you know, high tech, high growth companies, getting as many minorities to invest in the VC asset class to turn this generational wealth gap on our side, right? So putting more people in position to be investors in venture capital, but also giving them the access, and then also having founders receive these funds to be able to, you know, solve the pain points they're going out to solve and change their communities and their generations as well.
Definitely. So give a man a round of applause for that, man. We definitely need that, man. We definitely need, because, you know, I've been in the fundraising process, and I just, when you walk in that room and you see us, there's a certain level of, like,
founders, man, tell me that all the time.
And they're going to get it.
It's refreshing to see a face that looks like me on the opposite side of this Zoom, because I'm not used to this.
Right.
And you understand that you can relate to me a certain type of way that these other people aren't asking the questions that I expect them to ask and want them to ask for them to understand the value of my company. Right. So, I mean, Jill, Bert Solomon, and those people at Collab Capital are doing it. You know, it's many people who do this, and I'm just, you know, a pebble in the sand, right? So being able to just all come together and really grow this thing and really change this movement.
That's what's up, man. Before we wrap up, man, you got any advice you want to give to somebody that's on their journey to the league, bro, to the big show?
Yeah, I mean, first things first, right? Control the controllables. One thing you asked me was, is it all politics? I mean, there's politics involved, right? So knowing that you're not going to get everything you deserve, and things are not going to always go your way. It's a lot of shit's out of your control, but if you can control your effort, your attitude, how you prepare, what you do and bring to a team, and the value and how you train and take care of your body, if you control those little things, your attitude, all those things, your energy, then the rest will work itself out for you. I'm a big believer in everything happens for a reason, right? So if it doesn't work out for you, there's a different avenue, right? It didn't, you know, it wasn't my plan to tear my ACL year two of my NFL career, but that led me to open up my eyes to business and understand what I like, don't like, and really gravitate to where I'm at today. So control the controllables, and just, you just understand everything happens for a reason, because the game's not going to be nice to you. It's 100% injury rate, and shit's going to happen, right? Politics are going to be involved. Business is going to be involved. So you got to be able to sleep at night and understand that if you gave it all you got, you're doing right, right? You're going to be all right, and you're going to move forward in this game of life and whatever you do next.
That's what's up. That's what's up. Y'all got any questions for my man before we wrap up?
Nah, man. I mean, hey, this is a great combo. I think that a lot of nuggets was dropped in here. Love hearing that history, that story.
Nah,
great stuff. Even though I've heard a lot of it, but I learned more. You know what I'm saying? That's
let's dope. Go, Chubb. Let's go, Chubb.
That's dope.
Lightweight.
Nah, I'm glad to be here, bro.
Your wildest NFL story in 30 seconds or less.
I'm going to put myself out there because, you know, That's how it is. My rookie year, telling you about the L.A. story, right? We're in L.A. We're getting into these clubs. I'm getting into One Oak. So fast forward, I get into One Oak. I know the promoter. He lets me in, gets me in a section up top. And we have no bottles, right? Because obviously the table minimum pays for the bottles that come with what you pay for the table. And you can, you know, add on to it if you want to spend more money. So we get a table, empty table, got some girls with me, got some of my boys from college with me. And we got no bottles, right? And it's like $250 for a bottle, right? We're at this table. I think Bow Wow's there that night. This is 2016. Right?
Oh, shit.
Club is lit.
Oh, shit.
But it's like seven dudes, no girls, because we can't attract them over there because we got no alcohol. So me and my homeboy, I'm not going to say his name.
Me and my homeboy.
It's crazy. Looking on my phone, I'm like, yo, where's the nearest liquor store? So long story short, me and my homeboy leave the club. Wildest thing I've ever done. Looking back on it, nuts. Leave the club, go across the street, literally right across the street is a liquor store. We get four Ciroc bottles, probably, what, $30 to $35 a piece. Got on skinny jeans, but they're not that skinny. We put two Ciroc, I got thick thighs too, right? So put two Ciroc bottles, one in each leg. He's a 6'6", he's a tall guy. He puts two Ciroc bottles in his legs. We walk back into the section, put Ciroc bottles in our bucket, and got four bottles.
I kind of regret I asked that.
How crazy is that?
That's wild, bro.
Yeah, nobody's ever heard that story.
I ain't never had an NFL check. I ain't never did that one. That's a good one.
See, look.
That's the move.
Most niggas, when the security ain't patting you, they bringing that gun and shit. Right. This nigga bring him
like, we sneaking in bottles, nigga.
Banana, it's a rock clip. Some
hey, look. Them bitches came in, though. Okay.
It's funny, though, because they know what you paid for. Your bottle girl knows, you know, if you order bottles or not. So she sees for Ciroc bottles. They got onto us, right? So, you know, you got the mixer, you got the orange juice, little vase, you got the cranberry. So we had to start, you know, pouring the Ciroc in the mixers and just, so now we're just fucking niggas lined up around the section just drinking orange juice like it's fuck. Like, we look crazy.
Because
everybody and their mama knows these niggas aren't getting drunk off orange juice. These niggas are having a great time off orange juice and cranberry.
Man, we look
nuts.
Nah, that's bad.
And they come check us. We stiff. We hide the Ciroc bottles in the couch. It was a crazy story. And that was my last time going to One Oak in West Hollywood.
Because
I couldn't even look the promoter in the face no more because, you know, he let me in and put his name out on put his neck out.
Oh my God.
Hey, that's why Coach wasn't fucking with you.
He must have heard the story.
That is fucking.
But this is like, you know, we're out there right after we get drafted, mini camp. So it's like April, May,
and
June.
You still young. You said 21.
Yeah, and you ain't got paid yet. Just because you out there on the team,
season,
you get paid per game. We ain't had a game yet.
I feel that.
I had a signing bonus. I ain't had a game yet.
That's a good story.
I love this shit, bro. I love it. Like, you have a great story. Anything else you want to say to the world, man? Anything else?
Nah, I mean, I'm just glad to be here, bro.
I'm glad we did this too, bro. We've been waiting. It's been a long time coming.
I appreciate you. You bought my dinner the other day, and that meant a lot. You know what I'm saying? Had some great cauliflower nuggets from the gathering spot. So great to, you know, see this thing come full circle.
Yeah, bro. Excited about it, man. For me, man, I just want to say congratulations to all the athletes out there who can take their destiny in their own hands. That's what I really see that as. I just want to let y'all know, man, you're a brand right now. You're a brand right now, and you got to begin to walk in the reality that you're reaching for. So if you feel like you're about to be the next Steph Curry, like, position yourself to be that cat.
Got to.
Like, you
got
to position yourself to be that cat and, you know, ultimately get paid. So, again, thank you for coming, brother. Thank y'all for listening to another episode. We say this every week. We love y'all to be y'all, but most importantly, we can't wait to see y'all next week. This is Just Eldredge Podcast.
Hey! Your girlfriend here.
Hey, what is that moment?
I was at a weightlifting competition my senior year. And he scrubbed off YouTube. Yeah, this is your I'm over here power cleaning. They're like, my boys are hyping me back and hyping me up in the background for a power clean. I was like 315 at the time, 315 pounds, and won a competition. So,
what comes to mind when you hear the word highlights?
No, he's talking about the
all right, hold on. Like, just for the people, play it. Start it from the beginning one time. I don't want to fuck up his drop. My boy got a podcast too.
Highlight podcast.
Drop my boy shit. Let's go.
Career, industry, or community. No gain on.
Your girl here.
Oh, that's what he was saying. Your girlfriend was in?
This is your host, Brandon Chubb, and you're listening to the Highlights Podcast, where we highlight individuals' unique stories, perspectives, and journeys.
Going to the ground with Donald, Brandon Chubb.
What comes to mind when you hear the word highlights? Maybe touchdowns, dunks, home runs? Well, every week, my guest who joins me on this podcast has touchdown, dunks, or home runs in their everyday career, industry, or community.
No gain on the play, and that's Brandon Chubb again.
Every week, a new guest will get highlighted, so press play, turn the volume up, enjoy, and share it.
Let's go.
This is Highlights, Highlights, Highlights.
And that is a New Voices fucking production. Goddamn, Keith Haygood, quit playing with that nigga, man. Quit playing with that nigga.
That boy Keith.
Jeez. That boy Keith.